Welcome. We're excited to be back videoing our teaching in 2 Corinthians. And let's start off by going to the author of 2 Corinthians, and I don't mean Paul. Let's pray. Oh God, thank you for your word. Thank you for particularly this magnificent book, and I'm getting so much out of it. And Holy Spirit, we just ask you to be with us and with those that are watching. And open up your word, open our hearts, speak to us, and let us share and understand you and know your word better and just reveal yourself. Amen. All right, so turn to chapter 4 of 2 Corinthians. And big picture, one of the reasons I like 2 Corinthians is because, excuse me, this wasn't froggy all day, but I hadn't been out in the cold. 2 Corinthians means so much to me because it's so much repeated over and over and over that our life is pain and loss and weakness and troubles. And in that, that's real and it should be, but we seek Him and how He comes to our aid. And that there's a purpose we're going to look at today. And we look at over and over and over. We started in chapter 1, where Paul started out because he was suffering so much. And he said, remember, we were utterly burdened, chapter 8 and 9, and verses 8 and 9, chapter 1. Beyond our strength, we despaired of life itself. Indeed, we felt we'd received the sentence of death. But that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. He's delivered us from such a deadly peril, and He will deliver us. On Him we set our hope that He will deliver us again. And this is the message that happens over and over and over and over in 2 Corinthians. And so chapter 4 is full of it. So we're going to spend some time. We're going to breeze through part of it, and then we're going to take and we're going to really digest some of the second half of it. All right, so open up with me if you will. Let me get my papers here. Okay, so I'm going to open the Bible up. All right, so 2 Corinthians 4. And let's look down to verse 7. Because we have done some of this and it didn't get videoed, but we've discussed it. So we're going to back up and get our context. So verse 7. Here we go. All right, so he's talking about, he's making reference in the first part of chapter 4 to what he was talking about in chapter 3, which is about Moses and the veil that he had to wear over his face. In Exodus 36, I think, and that he had a veil because he was reflecting the Shekinah glory. He had been the actual presence of Christ and actually was glowing white. And so he put a veil so it didn't scare people and so forth, and there are some other things. So that's addressed in chapter 3. And then in 4, he says, oh, by the way, the beauty of the Gospels, there's a veil over the heart of unbelievers, and so until that veil's removed, it means nothing to them. So that's what the veil references. And then he says, so we have this honor that we get to carry the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ in verse 6. And then he says, but, and we've stayed enough to know that but is a contrast word. He goes, that's true. And then he says, but we have this treasure in jars of clay to show the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. So my question is, when he says we have this surpassing treasure, what is he talking about? The but links it, so it's a hint. So those of you that haven't answered the question before recently, look and see, what is this amazing treasure that he refers to? It's got to be before the but. Mm-hmm. Now, in fact, you can go to the end of 4 and in verse 6. Guess what you think the treasure might be.
Would it be the gospel?
The gospel is a treasure that we hold. What else? What's something else? Another G word.
Glory.
Talking about the glory of Christ in us. Remember the picture was Moses being up on the mountain, physically in the presence, and there was physical light, like at the transfiguration, and that physical light was on him. And in this case, it's saying we have this treasure, which is the gospel, the light of the gospel, the glory of Christ, and then the knowledge of the glory of God. So we have the gospel, the glory of Christ. That's the treasure we have inside of us. Because the big difference, and we're going to get over into it in, I don't know, maybe Galatians, I'm not sure. I've been reading through the New Testament. I can't remember where everything is, but I remember reading it. There is this incredible difference between a New Testament believer and an Old Testament believer. Where did the Old Testament believers go to be in the presence of God? Into the tabernacle, into the temple, up on the mountain. Where do New Testament people, believers go to be in the presence of God?
Here.
Because where's the presence of God right now?
Here.
We're indwelt. And this is the difference between Old Testament and New Testament. We have to dwell somewhere to be with him. In the Old Testament, the New Testament, we're indwelt. And that's what it's telling. We have the glory of God inside of us. We have the gospel inside of us. All right? So that's wonderful. Well, how does he describe what we're like carrying it around? What?
Jars of clay.
Jars of clay. Used to be a group. I don't know if they still sing it. Jars of clay is still a group? Used to be. I don't know. Okay? Jars of clay. All right? So, what do we think of, sir? We've got this surpassing glory of God in jars of clay. And so this is talking about, let's see here, worse than even styrofoam cups. Remember in offices when they used to have those little Dixie cups that were little triangle-shaped Dixie cups? And they were just, I mean, they must have been like a half a penny a piece. They just weren't worth anything. And so that's what the comparison is. The surpassing glory of Christ indwelt in us and the gospel, and we're just those little crummy little Dixie cups. That's what a jar of clay is. And so in the Old Testament, you could weave your baskets. Sometimes things were made of wood, but so many things were made out of clay. So the whole potter concept that's throughout the Bible, there's a picture of it, and that's what they were making. And so jars of clay were cheap vessels. And they, you know, if you've ever had some kind of fragile pottery and you bump it on something, or you have one of your really pretty china plates and someone drops it on your ceramic tile or your brick floor, what happens? So they're very fragile, but these aren't worth anything. It's not like china. So we have this fantastic treasure in jars of clay. So clay is made of earth. And where do you first remember the Bible talking about man being made of earth? In Genesis. Remember? He actually made Adam out of the dust of the dirt of the ground. So it's just continuing the same picture. And so the clay vessel is worthless except for the prize that it carries. It's the amazing prize. There are several really good verses on the clay and the potter. One of them is, go back to Jeremiah 18. So Jeremiah is in the Old Testament. There's Psalms and Proverbs kind of in the middle. And then you have, go to the right, and you can see Isaiah. And go a little bit further, and you can see Jeremiah. And go to Jeremiah 18. It's a very, you've probably heard the illustration before. So a lot of times in the New Testament, we have a spiritual picture that is a physical picture in the Old Testament. For example, They literally went into a physical tabernacle, and we have God tabernacling in us. So there's a spiritual picture where they're physical. So in Jeremiah 18, the Lord sends Jeremiah, look in verse 1. And so he's going to give Jeremiah a physical picture of this spiritual picture we're talking about. The word came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Arise and go to the potter's house, and there I'll let you hear my words. So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working his wheel. We're talking about a potter's wheel. And the vessel he was making, and there's the word vessel. And so that's what we're talking about. But this is physical, where what we're talking about, we aren't physically jars of clay. But this is the picture. And the vessel he's making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand. And so maybe he was trying to make a water pitcher out of it, and it did something wrong, so he decided to make it just maybe something to carry fruit in, or something like that. Spoiled in the potter's hand, and reworked into another vessel as it seemed good to the potter to do. Everyone would agree that's an appropriate thing, right? Every potter has the right. In fact, they would be a bad potter if they kept trying to make something out of something that's broken. So he can just change it and do something, go, well, that's bad clay, we'll throw that away, and we'll just make a little tiny pot, whatever it was. Okay, now it gets tough, because it starts applying to us. Then the word of the Lord came to me. Oh, Israel, can I not do with you as this potter has done? Declares the Lord. Behold, like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. So he's talking to Israel, but it's the same thing. He is the potter, we are the clay. He has the right to do whatever he wants. And this is one of the most graphic illustrations he has here. And the same with you. Does it bother you that God gets to do what he wants to with you and he won't do what you tell him to do? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, don't we try to tell God all the time and convince him? And he's going, wait, I'm the potter. You're the clay. And so this is the imagery. So one of the things I would suggest you do is write this down, and then this week in your meditation time, think about how you fight the potter all the time. And that you're trying, you know, doesn't the potter have the right to do anything he wants to with the clay? Yes. But me, I fight that. Right? So that's Jeremiah 18 if you want to go to that. Now flip over to the New Testament to Romans 9. 20, and we'll just read part of it. Okay, so Romans is just after Acts, which is just after Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And so in Romans 9, verse 20, but who are you, O man, to answer back to God? Will what is molded say to it, molder, why have you made me like this? So it's exactly what was going on, except this time he's applying it to us as people. Please raise your hand if you say to the molder, why have you made me like that? Have you ever said this to God? Okay, look how stupid we are, right? We are definitely jars of clay. And then he goes on to say, has a potter no right over the clay to make out of the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable? Okay. This is great to think about, particularly when you're arguing with God. Whether it's you don't have something you think you should have, or you have something you don't think you should have, or he should work in a different time. I mean, if you've ever done any pottery, it has to be done under certain specifications, and it has to dry a certain way, and you have to keep it in the kiln a certain time, and you have to go thin, or it all falls apart in your hand, and you have to start all over again. So these are just great verses reminding us this principle. Oh, by the way, I'm the potter, you're the clay. Why don't you trust me because I know what I'm doing? Because we would scoff if we found a potter asking clay, what do you want me to make of you? You know, did you like this? And that's nothing. We're talking about God and us. Any thoughts or questions?
It's also a hard verse, though, too. I mean, when you read on, you know.
Yeah, and then it gets on.
Yeah.
Gets into deeper application of this. And it is. There's some good verses there, but the application is, he has the right as God to do exactly what he wants. And our job is to understand that this presents him as a good, merciful, sovereign, loving. Romans 8 says it's always for his glory and our good. And our job as jars of clay and as lumps, we need to see God right to understand why he has the right to be like this and why it's best for us when we can't. So these are the verses you go through. Any other thoughts or questions you have? This is a heavy thought. We're giving God up the right to do anything he wants with us. Any questions or thoughts? We haven't recorded in a long time, and so our group's a little bit quiet, not talking too much. That's okay. All right, so he's talking about what? But we have this treasure in jars of clay, and then what does to show do for us? What do those next two words do for us? We're back at verse 7 in chapter 4. What does to show tell us? Is it an example? Is it something contrasting? What does it say, this is this way to show? What would the to show be telling you?
It's the purpose.
Purpose or reason. Mm-hmm. Would you like to know why he made you a lump of clay and he can do anything he wants? Let's read and find out, because he did this to show, and now he's going to tell you why. To show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. It's the same thing in chapter 1 that I read. It was so we could learn not to depend on ourselves but on him. He's trying to show us, and watch for this power. The word power comes up over and over. And the word surpassing doesn't mean like really nice. It's like over, super, super, more than that, more, much more, exceedingly more, more, more. It's our word hyperbole in English. I mean, it's like the most it could be, power. So he's saying, you're my jar of clay, and I'm doing what I'm doing, and I'm having you be a jar of clay, so it's very clear to show the surpassing power belongs to me and not to you. And so this is the purpose for hardships. So we learn who is the master and who is dependent on him. And who gets the glory and who is the servant. And I can't run my life. He's got to. Now, this dredges up a lot of hard stuff. Now, if your life has been really easy, except you failed a test once, and you broke a fingernail last year. And so if your life has been like that, you kind of go, yeah, okay. But if life has been hard, this is an answer to the hard stuff. Okay? All those places that are hard, where he's acting as potter, and we're just the wonderful vessels that get to carry him around, he's saying, I want you to know the surpassing power belongs to me and not to you. Would you want a God who is sovereign that did not have the power to do what he believed best? No. So actually, we don't want to take away from that surpassing power. I want him to have all the power because I can't do it. Life has convinced me I can't. So I certainly want him to have that surpassing power. And he's saying, that's why I set it up like this. So when you face that and go, oh, wow, I cannot do that. I blew it again. I made a careless error last week. Trying to not make it, I made the careless error. And I almost got locked into a building all night long by myself, and no one knew I was there. And I was working hard not to get locked in to redemption's office. Because the door shuts behind you and it's locked. And I was working really hard. That's why I carry my purse here, because I don't want to get locked in out of the building without my keys, because I have them on my purse. So I was working really hard not to make a mistake. And I came this close, praise God, I had my phone with me. So I was able to get somebody to come and get me out. But if I hadn't, I would have had to make the hard decision. That's how hard I was working not to make a silly little mistake. Then we've got all of our lives. So I want you to just take a second, and I want you to think about, are you truly thankful that he has a surpassing power and you don't? So just take a minute or two, jot down, you at home if you want to, stop and write longer on it. Think about, are you thankful that the surpassing power, over and beyond super duper, hyperbole on hyperbole, exceeding power, belongs to him and not you? Even in the tough stuff, especially in the tough stuff. Mm-hmm. Okay, now I want you to come back to this. And another place that this is a picture, go back if you want to read in Judges 7, and it's the story of Gideon. And if you know the story where he had, 30,000 people or 300,000, and the Lord said, no, send them home, and they got down to 10,000, they got down, and then they had to drink water out of a certain way, and those that bent down, whatever, and they just got like, 300 men, they had to go against a huge army. But what they did is he said, I want to show you so you can't brag that the victory is mine. Again, the glory of God. And they had earthen vessels, and they cracked the earthen vessels and let the light shine through, which is what, when we have the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ inside of us, our cracks allow that light to show through, just like the picture of Gideon. So take some time this week, maybe you can go back and read that and apply it to this and think about your own life. All those cracks and weaknesses and all of that, the light shines through. Just like it did. If they had never cracked those pots, the light wouldn't have come out. So it's a good example. And there's a really good prayer. Look at Ephesians, which is just a couple of books to the right. So go to Ephesians 1. And it's a really good prayer related to this, I think. So look at Ephesians. It's a great prayer there in Ephesians 1. But specifically for this, the words are very similar. And again, it means it's talking about the difference between us and the infinity and perfection of God. All of these verses are focusing on that. So look at Ephesians 1, 18 through 20. So as you're meditating, as you want to pray on this, look at this. Having the eyes of your heart enlightened, now we're talking about light again, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead. So what kind of power are we talking about here?
Resurrection
power. So here we are, as you struggle with being a broken, cracked pot. Look at this. Pray this. Ask God to let the eyes of your heart be enlightened by him. And then he begins to list not only immeasurable power available, but the wonderful riches because he dwells in us. So I think these are related, that this would be a prayer, because we will struggle. We will be crackpots all of our lives in different areas, even when we're trying not to be. I mean, we're trying to do the right thing. We can't even when we try all the time. All right, a question or a thought here. Okay, then what we're going to do is we're going to pause for a second, and I want you all to discuss together with your partners at your tables and then you at home if you're with someone, or to write out your thoughts and your struggles at being a cracked, broken, easily broken vessel. And the healthy purpose in it is to show what. And so focus on this. Why is it important, and where do you struggle, and then talk about this glorious thing that it's about him. And our weakness reveals how glorious he is. And maybe you could share with people, if there's an opportunity, a way you have seen that he revealed himself to be glorious and wonderful in your weakness. Because that's what so much is repeated here. Do you understand what we're going to talk about? Mm-hmm. Okay, your struggles with being a crackpot and weak and breakable, which we kind of wish we aren't, but this says it's a great trade-off. Mm-hmm. So talk about your struggle, and then talk about this great trade-off, okay? So you at home, pause, and we'll come back and talk when you're finished. Okay, I hope you got some things down. These questions are good questions to go back to when you're meditating, when you're spending some time with the Lord and thinking, okay, to go back to it. Okay, so in studying this, it says, but we have this what in jars of clay?
Treasure.
So the whole thing is giving God all the glory, and it kind of says, okay, we're weak crackpots. So, and when I was studying this, I found something that I just thought, oh my goodness, because he could get all the glory. But do you notice all the blessings we read about in that Ephesians 1 prayer of all the things he's given us? And I found something really amazing. Go back to Deuteronomy. So it's Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. So it's the fifth book in the beginning of the Bible. And go to chapter 7. So chapter 7 of Deuteronomy. And this is just, and I like the ESV, because other versions don't say this as well as ESV does. So, Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6. Again, he's talking to Israel, but put your name in here. Listen to this. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for his treasured possession. What word is in this again?
Treasure.
Okay. Is he saying he's putting the treasure? What is he saying about a treasured possession? It's us. Look at this. The Lord chose me to be for his treasured possession. Not a treasured possession, his treasured possession. You want to have some self-worth? Look at this. There isn't more self-worth anywhere than this. He chose me for his treasured possession. Out of all the peoples on the face of the earth, it was not because I was more in number or something about me than all the other people that the Lord set his love on me and chose me. For I was the fewest of all the people. I had nothing to bring. But it's because the Lord loves me. If you are his daughter, this is true about you. Now he's using Israel, and this is saying, I mean, have you ever looked at a map of the world? Okay, Israel is this little tiny itty bitty thing. It's hard to find it on a big map. And everything within 2,000 miles has all the petroleum and oil reservoirs that you could ever want in the history of the world, except for Israel. How many oil wells do you have? So it's this tiny little sliver of a country. They're nothing. And he says, I chose you to be my treasured possession of all the peoples on the whole earth, all seven continents. You. It's not because you brought anything to the table, because you were special, because there's anything, because you had oil reserves. It was nothing. But I chose to set my love on you. I chose you. I love you. So you want to know why God loves you? I mean, why he chose you? Why you're special? Simply because he loves you. Out of all the people on the earth. So don't make this plural, make this personal. I've been working on trying to memorize it, and it's a little tricky with the way the words. And so at night when I go to bed, I'm still working on memorizing it. This gives me such worth. I'm his chosen, treasured, beloved, possession. And so I trust him with what he's doing with the clay and my life because of this. This is marvelous. So, and the way I remember it is 76, which is a, you know, 1776, a big number in the United States history. So it just helps me remember 76. It's Deuteronomy 7:6 to go there. And you want to work on your self-worth, memorize this and put your name in there. So what a fantastic thing. Talks about treasure. So it would have been enough if he had just put his treasure in us. But he also calls us his treasured possession. Okay, any thoughts or questions? Okay, then we get into four sets of this, but not this. So he's talking about the hardships. Remember, there's a whole lot about hardships in real life in 2 Corinthians. And so he's just finished saying, oh, by the way, you have this fantastic treasure of God and the glory and this the gospel, Jesus Christ, in you, so it can show that he has this absolute power. And then he talks about four different ways that we can have hard times. And he contrasts them. And what we're going to do is look through the words. And it's just amazing. And you know plays on words? In the Greek, these are mostly plays on words. Like a pun almost. But he does plays on words. And so I'm going to go over this. And I want you... This is just such fantastic. Let's read what the four things are. So it says, we are. When is that? Yeah. Now. So this can be at any time and all the time. We're afflicted in every way, but not crushed. We're perplexed, but not driven to despair. We're persecuted, but not forsaken. We're struck down, but not destroyed. Always carry around in our bodies the death of Jesus, so the life of Jesus may be manifested in our bodies. Okay, the second half of this is a principle that's only found in Scripture, and that is life comes from death. Mm-hmm. Where is the biggest picture of that?
The
resurrection. Mm-hmm. Okay, life comes from death. So our baptism, it's the picture of life coming from death. We're dead in Christ, we're raised to new life. And the resurrection concept. So this is saying, we want to show you something. And part of it, again, there's a purpose. So that in the death of me to myself and in my struggles, the life of Jesus Christ can be manifest. So that's the principle. And now I'm going to read through this and show you. Okay, so it says, first, we're afflicted in every way. Okay, afflicted is the word kalupsis or something like that, and it means to make narrow, constrict by pressure. It can be absolute sheer physical pressure on you. It's when circumstances make you feel hemmed in. Circumstances are coming at you like this. What in the world am I going to do? Best picture of this is, and it's happened so much, but the idea of Indiana Jones. I think in all his movies, there's a place where suddenly gets in a room, and the room starts shrinking this way, and the room starts shrinking this way. And he, that's the ellipsis. He is being hemmed and confined and like this. So that's what this word for afflicted means. But specifically, it's talking about the internal pressure. You know when you're in an affliction or trial, sometimes it's all the stuff on the outside. We're going to get to that in a minute. But this is the inward pressure you feel. It's appropriate, okay? When Bill died and I was a widow with five children at home, I felt a lot of inward. I felt like I was him. I had no options. I couldn't escape, and here I am, Indiana Jones. Okay, I'm hemmed in. I don't know where to go. That's what this word. It's a strong term that does not refer to minor inconveniences, but to real hardships. So I mean, real stuff in real life, not, oh, I broke another fingernail. Okay. It's when it weighs down your spirit. If, and see, this isn't like Indiana Jones. First the person's limited, then walled in, and then gradually squeezed so much that something's going to have to give. Indiana Jones, perfect picture, except you know, they always do the whatever. You know, and he reaches and grabs his hat. The picture of Flipsis is one being squeezed, a burden on your heart, and disappointments, and you feel like it's going to crush the life out of you. Okay? That's back in that first chapter, 8 and 9, says we despaired even of life. I feel like what this affliction is going to crush the life out of me. And then he says, look, we are afflicted. This is life. If you're in this place of life, I'm telling you, it's not necessary. Unless you're in sin, this is life. And it says, expect this. It's what the, it's used for the pressing of grapes to get wine out of it. And the thing is that when you squeeze a tube of toothpaste, what comes out?
Toothpaste.
So when you get squeezed, what's on the inside comes out. Grapes are really nice, but you can't drink grapes. So when you squeeze grapes, you get grape juice, eventually to get wine. Remember, believers have Christ in them, the hope of glory. And therefore, we have the potential to release the fragrance of Him when we're crushed. Does anybody remember when we talked about this? Remember in, back in chapter 2, when it's talking about we always lead this in triumph? And it exudes this beautiful aroma. Okay, that's what this is talking about. When life is crushing you, because we have Jesus Christ in us, we can exude the aroma of Christ when we're being crushed. Okay. This is the same picture in Matthew 13 when it talks about the seeds being sown and the one that pops up real quickly, but the pressures of the world, okay, that's that same picture. And then in John 16, Jesus says, in this world you will have Philipsis, but take heart, I've overcome the world. So there's nothing here going, oh, you know that fun thing about being a Christian? Mm-hmm. And all that goes away. This is saying, okay, we will have tribulations like this. We will have affliction. Now, He's overcome it. And, but look at the promise here. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Because remember Indiana Jones? Okay, it looks like you're going to be crushed. You feel crushed. But the promise is here. We're not. So look what the word is. It's a word that focuses on external pressure and external circumstances. Again, it's a different word that talks about a narrow place that hems you in and offers no way of escape. So what he's saying is, you feel that pressure, you're Indiana Jones, and it's and you go, okay, I'm doomed. I'm going to be crushed. He says, but you're not. There isn't no way of escape. There is a way of escape. So when you're going through this kind of affliction, and you go, okay, I am going to be crushed. He promises, no, you're not. Because there is a way. We are never without a way of escape. And that's what this crush says. You're not going to be crushed. You have a way of escape. We talked about it when we did 1 Corinthians. Keep your finger here and look at 1 Corinthians 10:13. If you have not memorized it, this is a verse that needs to go on your list to memorize. Meditate on. Are you in an affliction right now? And you go, there is no way out. Now, it may be not a nice, easy, happy way out, but God promises you there's a way out. Look what it says in 1 Corinthians 10:13. No affliction has overtaken you or tried to crush you. That's not common to man. God is faithful. He will not let you be crushed in him in beyond your ability. And with that affliction, he will also provide a way of escape so you may endure it. Okay? This promise is linked exactly with the same concept. So you go, well, I can't get out of this. I have no way of escape. Wrong. That's what it's saying. You may feel like there's no way of escape, but this is like the best Indiana Jones movie ever because of God. There's always in him his way of escape. Now, it might be like you may lose a treasured relationship. You may lose your fortune. You may lose your reputation. You may not have what you wanted, but Jesus Christ will take you through. And he goes, I promise you, you will not be crushed. That's what this is saying. And again, it goes back up here because he said, so the power belongs to God and not to us. The same idea. When you go through this, you get to see God working in a way you would not have without it. Mm-hmm. And then we go back again to 1 Corinthians where it says, so we can comfort, or was it 2 Corinthians? We can comfort others with the comfort we've been comforted with. Okay? You find out, I met with a widow last week, and she has only been a widow 2 years, and she has sons still in her home. Well, I can share so much with her to say, oh, by the way, I thought it was going to crush me. It didn't. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you what I know about Jesus and what I've learned and who he is. So all of this just paints this great picture. So when you are sharing with a sister and she's going, okay, I'm Indiana Jones. I mean, I'm going to be crushed. You go, let me show you what the Word of God and let me give you the testimony in my life. And take her to 1 Corinthians 10:13 and show her who God is. Question or thought? Okay, then let's look at the next. Oh, and it was, let's see. Some people that I got some of this information, they had these cute little titles to it. So that was squeezed but not squashed. Okay? And the next one's bewildered but not befuddled. Okay, so we're perplexed but not despairing. And now I'm going to explain what these words are. This means I'm in this difficulty. I am in this hard thing, and I am at my wit's end. Literally, it means, again, to be without a way or path. To be at a loss what to think or do. Have you ever said, I just don't know what to do? You may have said it today. Lord, I just don't know what to do. That's what this word perplexed is talking about. It's not like, I wonder what the 4 Greek words are for that. It's not like I was trying to help my son-in-law with some algebra, college algebra, and it went to something I knew nothing about. It's not that kind of perplexed. It's talking about life. The perplexing, it's okay to be perplexed. It's expected. It's saying we're perplexed. We don't know which way to turn. We're uncertain. We might be very confused. It might bring a lot of doubt. Or really disturbed because we don't know what to do. I mean, if I only had a dollar for every time I told the Lord, Lord, I don't know what to do. Lord, I don't know what to do. Out loud or in my heart, we could all make a really nice little trip to some warm island in the Caribbean. Okay, because I did it over and over and over again. Those words, I don't know what to do. To be without resources. This is saying, I don't know what to do. I can't. Like, working that algebra problem, I was without resources. And it said, use a graphing calculator. I don't know how to use it. I'm without resources. I don't know how to. Then my engineering son came home and he went, oh, let me show you. He had resources. But this feeling where you don't know, without resources, you're perplexed. The idea we're often in situations not knowing which way to go and not seeing a way open. Okay? That's what this is. Okay? So many times in life, in parenting, ministry, marriage, all relationships, finances, everything, after saying and doing everything you might notice, say and do, and those you're trying to help, and they may be believers or not believers, remain completely out of reach and turn against you. I'm trying to help this person. Spent the morning with someone who's got someone in their very close relationships who's made a very immoral choice. And they're choosing to live in this lifestyle, this immoral choice. And she's trying to love and show truth and so forth. And they're going, not interested. That is very perplexing. I don't know what else to do. Lord, what else do I do? Okay, so it says we are perplexed. We feel like this. But we don't despair. That's the thing. If you've ever despaired, God is trying to tell you, don't go into despair. This is that don't lose heart that we've said like 3 times already in this book. Okay? It's an intensive form. It's exactly the same word. So in English, we don't have a word that means ultra perplexed, but it's we're perplexed, but not ultra perplexed so much to getting to the point of despairing. And that's what it actually says in the Greek. But we can't do that. This is to be utterly without resources. We feel like we're not with resources. No, you're never without resources. Okay? To be in utmost despair. To be left in a strait, in a thumbing, with no way out. Again, has the no, like a no exit strategy. You don't have a good alternative. And God's saying, I'll never leave you like that. You do not need to despair. Okay? It's really hard. And it's very perplexing, and it feels like you don't know what to do. But I will never let you get to despair. I always have resources for you. So these words, perplexed and despairing, because see, the Greek is so rich here, and I've just pulled so much to share a little bit. They're the same word, and so the first one says, yes, I feel perplexed. I don't know what to do. I'm confused. But you never have to feel that you're totally at a loss, so you despair. Okay? We never have utter hopelessness because of God. It says Jesus is our living hope. He lives inside of me. So no matter how bad it gets, don't go into utter despair because we have the living hope living inside of us. He has all the resources. You might be at the brink of defeat, but you're never defeated because of Jesus. That verse in 2 Corinthians 1:8, listen to Psalm 43:5. If you struggle with this or know something, Psalm 43:5 you should memorize. Why are you downcast, O my soul? Why are you in turmoil? Why are you in turmoil with me? That's my heart. Whoa! Okay? Hope in God. For I shall again praise him, my salvation, my God. He is my way out. He is my hope. So it's not necessarily like he's going to give you these really brilliant exit strategies and, okay, so I've got this relationship that's a mess or something. I do want children. I can't have them. I don't want children. I do have them. I want to be married. I'm not. I'm not married. I want to be. Whatever it is. Okay? There is wisdom. But we have to remember, he himself is our way out. He is our hope. Okay? 1 Peter 1:3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again, this is the verse, into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So we don't have cross your fingers hope. We have a living hope because of the resurrection, and he lives inside of us. And we live in him. Does this make sense? Okay. And it's so amazing. Poreo is the first word, and aporeo is the second one. So again, there continue to be words that play off of each other. Okay, and the next one, that group that had these cute little terms, they didn't have one for this one. And I said, Jonathan, can you think, because he was the only one around, can you think of words that would... Okay, persecuted but not forsaken. Right? And so we know the big thing about persecution, but listen to what this is. This is to pursue someone with all haste, to chase after them, to overtake them. Okay? It's a hunting term.
Persecuted is?
Persecuted. It's with great, it's like a hound after the fox. But let's not have a fox, let's have a rabbit. Okay? And you have 10 hounds, and they're out chasing that poor little rabbit. And they're going fast. And they're circling around, and they're going after, and they go through the briar patch, and that poor little rabbit's heart pounding out of its chest. And those dogs, what are they going to do when they get a hold of it? Rip it apart, right? This is what this word means. It's a really serious word. It's literally to pursue one like they do a fleeing enemy. And it conveys the sense with the intention of doing harm. So this is not like someone going, look, I really want, and there's something. This is, they want to overtake you and do harm. I so identify totally with this. After we lost Bill, we didn't have great financial resources, but we had some insurance policies through his business. The company was good, and it's not a huge amount of money, but when you don't have any money, a lot of money is a huge amount of money. And so it was going to be what it's going to be now is help me in my retirement. So it's a good amount of money, but not this enormous several millions of dollars or anything like that. So everything was working out, and they went, oh no, we found this one glitch in your, what you said and did to be signed up for this money. And I had everything, because I write down the right people's names. And I go, no, because on September 22nd, I spoke to Marilyn, and I literally said, is there anything else I need to do to make sure this is effective? And she said, no, you've done everything. You don't have any. I go, so everything is taken care of, absolutely. And I had that written down in my notebook. So I came back in the middle, well, we sent you a postcard. I never got the postcard, you know. Yeah, well, we're real sorry. And I go, no, because Marilyn on September 22nd. And so I start, and I got a hold of Marilyn. And she said, yeah, you're right. I did say that. That did happen. Well, that got bumped up the ladder. And I got on with a supervisor, and she said, you want to talk to us, you talk with our lawyers, talk to your lawyer, talk to our lawyer. You are not allowed to talk to any people anymore. This is closed to you. You can't do it. And I felt like the little rabbit. Mm-hmm. And the insurance, this is MetLife with Snoopy. Snoopy did me wrong. Okay. But it was the company saying, no, we're not going to pay. Mm. So I felt literally, because I had men to go to that had some church I was in, they were the pastors. And I said, you have no idea what I feel like. Mm. I am that little rabbit. And the hounds are chasing me, and everywhere I turn, there's another jaw like this. Okay? So I identify with this feeling. Not being persecuted for being a believer, but being in a circumstance where they were hounds after me. Okay? But this word says, oh, by the way, you may be in this circumstance, but there's good news in the second half. Okay? The word... Okay, so that's what persecuted means. And look what it says. You're persecuted, but not forsaken. And listen to this word, forsaken, because I'm telling you, he didn't forsake me. And if I'd never gotten the money, which was supernatural, because we did have to go to a lawyer, And the law, it turned out it was this mess of under a certain statute, and it was, we were 2 weeks out of having to drop the claim because we very likely would not be able to fight their big, have you ever read a John Grisham? Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'm the little guy and they're the big guys, mm-hmm. and then it turned out that it was under a certain statute that even if we did win, all they had to do is pay the money they owed, not pay any law fees, and if I lost, I had to give up the money and pay all their law fees. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was a John Grisham novel, haven't I? Okay. All right, so 2 weeks out, and he said, sure, you have 2 weeks, and we have to drop the claim or do something about it. Well, there was, and he called on a Thursday and said, would you like some good news? I go, yes, because they're going to pay. What do you mean they're going to pay? He says, I've been a lawyer for 30 years. I have never heard of an insurance company going back and paying. They don't pay regularly, but to go back and pay when they have no reason. They've won. And so when I ask him, I go, why in the world did they do it? And say, this is the Lord. He goes, we're dealing with insurance companies. Okay. God-forsaken insurance companies. Okay. So they paid when they didn't have to. And they paid me interest on the money. So when I went, it was almost exactly what I owed the lawyer for what he had done. To the penny. Okay. So just because it turned out all right doesn't prove this. If they had never paid, this would still be true. I'm just saying, I identify. Okay, so when you, there's an area or time in your life where you know somebody, you take them to this verse, and they go, I feel, particularly when you get into law, sometimes it feels like this. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Hope your husband's one of the good things.
Okay.
Because you're the little kid. A lot of times. All right. So, we're persecuted like a hound's after us, but not forsaken. Oh, this is a great word. It conveys the sense of deserting someone in a set of circumstances that they're in, abandoning them completely, and leaving them in a dire situation. To desert, the great expression is to leave in the lurch, but no one uses those terms, but to leave someone helpless in the midst of hostile circumstances. Not like they're trying to get their groceries in the car and you didn't help them. We're talking about dire circumstances. Remember, those hounds are going to do it if they catch you. So we're talking about that. It says, but we aren't left there. Promise comes out of Deuteronomy. Look at Hebrews 13:5. If you don't have it memorized, you've got to memorize Hebrews 13:5. So Hebrews is about 6 chapters from the back of the Bible, but this is it. Okay? Make sure that your character is free of the love of money and being content with such as you have. For he himself, so they really emphasize it, has said, I will never desert you. I will never forsake you. No matter what it feels like. No matter what the actual outcome is. Okay? If we've lost that money, he never deserted me. He himself has said he'll never forsake me. It's the picture of men in war. And you know in the good, wonderful, noble movies, they'll go back and get their buddy and sling them across their back. And they're willing to go through all the shots and the bombs and the everything to carry their buddy out. They're not going to leave them there. That's what Jesus Christ promised. I will never forsake you. I will always come to you. I will always be with you. And it, again, our English falls short on this because there are 5 nevers, nots in there. Because in English, if I say, well, no, I will not eat that, which means I will eat it. And if we go not, that means I won't eat it. Okay, so every time we add a not in English, it reverses. Mm-hmm. Not so. It just stacks up in Greek. So this is, I will never, 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 never leave you nor forsake you. That's what Jesus promised you. And this is he himself. So this is a promise from your God to you, no matter what it feels like. Okay. Question on that.
Is that Hebrews scripture?
Well, 13:5. Memorize it. Write down. This week, memorize these verses. You've got to have this. If you don't need it in your life, you should be in relationships with somebody who needs these verses. Mm-hmm. If you haven't memorized, get the tattoos up on your arms if you want. Or have it somewhere on your mobile device and go, verses I need to hand other people. And have it right there. Click. And you've got it so you can hand it to somebody. Okay, any other questions? I mean, this is amazing. Because it's saying you are going to go through tough stuff of some level, but look what Jesus Christ promised you. Okay, and the last one is knocked down but not knocked out. Okay, so this is, I guess if we're going to a movie with this one, let's see, earlier we had Indiana Jones, then we went to some really noble war movie where they go back in the jungle. Oh, wait, what's it? Box of Chocolates.
Forrest Gump.
What?
Forrest Gump.
Forrest Gump. You know, he goes back and gets whoever it is that lost his legs. Okay. But that sort of, so it's a war movie. So that's a war movie. And this one's probably some Rocky movie. Okay. I don't watch boxing movies. Oh, yes, I do. One of my very favorite movies of all time, Cinderella Man. Mm. But you clear plate, you take out the boxing. It's a great movie. Oh, I love it. So I filter it and I don't watch any of the boxing. So the 2.5 hour movie is about an hour and a half. I love it. Okay. But I'm not a boxing person. Okay. Knocked down but not knocked out. Okay. So he promises here, us here, that he says, you may be struck down, but you're not destroyed. So strike down means, and it is rocky, to have enough, to strike with enough force to knock you on the ground. It is literally, bam, a boxing move. As when one is hit with a weapon, or Rocky's fist, I guess. Used to describe either a knockdown in boxing or a throwdown. It's literally for them, because they had boxing and wrestling in Olympia, you know, the Olympics. And so it is literally a knockdown punch, okay? So you've been knocked down. You are cast down. It's bad. It's hurt. You've lost, okay? Whatever it is. I don't know if you've been there in your life in this, but I have. I'm out. I'm on the mat. And they're going, one, I don't know. Would they count up to ten? Whatever they do. Whatever it is they do in the part.
One, two, three, I think.
I don't watch. It's just three times, so it's like three strikes. Okay. Someone's ten. Okay. So I just skip that part. Okay, so we are literally struck down, but we're not destroyed. It means to cause to be lost, utterly perish by experiencing a miserable end.
That's destroyed.
It means cause to be lost, to be utterly perished, to utterly perish by experiencing a miserable end. Okay? And it, for the Greek, it would be the secular athletes where, it might be like, what's the thing where they get in the cages and they fight each other, like
UFC,
MFA or UFC. Okay, you know, and I mean, you know, sometimes they can do real damage, okay? So this is the athletic, again, seeing the Greek, we miss it. But in the Greek, they are rich with the metaphors of the words. And so it is being struck down, like you lose a match, you're knocked out in boxing, or you're pinned in wrestling. So someone knocks you out, that's what this actually means. But it has the concept, much worse than that, of utterly perishing with a miserable end. Okay? And Jesus is saying, no way. Okay? You might be struck down, but look who I am, I promise you. John 10:27-28. My sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. I'm sorry, it just means so much because God has done this for me in my life. And I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. There's that word. They will never perish. And no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one's able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. Period. Mm-hmm. We take this to the bank. And when you're hurting, don't keep it you. Say, me. Me. My Jesus, I am his sheep, and I hear his voice, and he knows me, and I follow him, and he gives me eternal life. And I will never perish, and no one can snatch me out of his hand. And my Father, his Father, who gave me to him, is greater than all. And no one is able to snatch me out of the Father's hand. Personalize this for yourself. Okay, Deuteronomy again, 33:27. The eternal God is your dwelling place, and underneath are the everlasting arms. So when you get knocked out, you don't fall to the mat. Where do you fall? Into his everlasting arm. And then we go back to John 10. And no one can snatch you out of his arms. It's almost like the Bible was written to all work together. You just have to find the pictures. All of it. What do you want? Okay. Yeah. John 10, 27 and 8. In Deuteronomy 33:27, underneath me the everlasting arms. Okay? So whatever it is in life that knocks you down, when you go down, you fall into the everlasting arms of God and Jesus. It's real. It's not pretend. Did he fix all the problems anywhere in here? No. Did it say it's all going to work out really nicely?
No.
No. Okay, at the end of the Indiana Jones, he always, I guess, gets a girl, he gets the trophy, he gets the whatever it is he went somewhere to get, and the money. Okay, it may not work out, but look at what he's promised from himself to you. A question?
One more time, John what? John 10?
John 10, 27 and 28.
Okay.
Fantastic verses. And this applies to your life in your heart, and it applies to your salvation. No one can snatch me out of the Father's hand. I am safe eternally, spiritually, and in this life. Even if I die. When I die, we're going to get to this verse in a little bit. We're going to get to where it says, okay, but absent from the body, present with the Lord. Okay? So if my life is taken from me, I fall into the everlasting arms of Jesus. If everyone deserts me and my life doesn't work out the way I want, and I'm still in his everlasting arms. Wow. And then it goes on to talk about the principle here is life out of death. And he talks about, that's the next section. Okay, and I want you to spend time on this, but I want to try and finish up the chapter because it continues. He says, so you have to understand, because life comes from death when it's really hard. Then skip down to verse 15. Okay, he's talked about all these hard things, being crushed, where we don't know what we're going to be, being knocked out, the tough stuff of real life. And look, it says here, for it is all for your sake, so that grace extends to more and more people, and the increase of the thanksgiving. Okay, I'm a broken vessel, all of this, but people, you hear my story. That's a pretty amazing thing. Okay, it was supernatural, period. But it wasn't the money. It was what Jesus Christ did when I was that rabbit, running, and how he came to me, and he never left me, and he never forsook me, I guess is the word, and all of this. That's the amazing thing, and the really nice end of the story is I got the money. Okay? But that wasn't why it was wonderful. It was all of this. And now I share that with you. You see his grace, and you give glory to God, and give thanks because he never left me. He never left me with a way out. Mm-hmm. And all the things I've been through, and you may have been through things that are worse than I will ever experience in this life. But I'm telling you, I felt I was out for the count. I felt like I had lived this. Mm-hmm. Look what Jesus has done. Mm-hmm. And he lives inside of me. Mm-hmm. And I'm his treasured possession. And so I give that to you. Okay? You are his treasured possession. And this is true for you. Okay? Verse 16. So do not lose heart there we again. Okay? Though our outer self, and this is what you can see. This is your physical, visible, real, physical body. Though our outer self is wasting away. What tense is that? Present tense. You know, the moment we're born, we start wasting away. Okay? And so this means uttermost decay. It is the idea of leading from bad to worse. Okay, it will continue. You die at a young age, your body may not get a chance to get all the way there. The longer you live, every moment your life is decaying. This is your physical body. Our outer life is decaying and is heading towards utter decay. But our inner self is being renewed day by day. Okay? My question is, the first half of that is absolutely true. The people with all the money in the world, can they stop their body from decaying? No. Okay, they might postpone it, they might use Botox, they might pull their skin and hop, but they can't stop it. Our outer bodies are decaying. That's guaranteed. The second part is not guaranteed. Our inner self, this is the inward, non-physical, spiritual part of us, is being renewed. What tense is that? Present tense. Let me hear you. Present tense. Day by day. Remember, one degree of glory to the next. Are you doing the second half of this? Because that's the encouragement. Verse 16, we don't lose heart. Yes, I'm telling you, this happens. Okay, you're going to end up, if you haven't started it, you're going to have more skin than you know what to do with. Okay? And always go, if I cut it off, then I couldn't move my arm. I go, where did all that skin go? There it is. Now you see me, now you don't. Okay, and all the rest of it. Okay, my outer stuff, it's going to happen. You live long enough, it happens. Okay, are you being renewed on the inside? Present tense. Are you being renewed today more than where you were yesterday? Are you living that, and as we look at that image, we're being transformed in that image, one degree of glory after the next. If you're not beholding that, 2 Corinthians 3:18, if we are not beholding that image, if we are not doing from our side, hungering and thirsting and drinking his word and seeking after him and caring more about the inside of our body than the outside of our body, we're not going to experience the second half. It's conditional. And then we would lose heart. I don't know how people who don't know him well cannot lose total heart. I don't know, because their life is going to look like this. And they don't have Jesus Christ to make these promises true. They fall, they're out. They don't have the everlasting lives. Right? So our job, if you want this wonderful not losing heart and this wonderful promise, you have got to be being renewed moment by moment, day by day, week by week. Okay? And then gives another promise. He's explaining why. He's going to say, you know that renewing? Let me explain to you about it. And this is another verse you're going to want to memorize. For this light, and okay, somewhere I have this written on. Yes. Okay, renewed means qualitatively. New and different. So you're not getting a new body. okay? But you're being renewed to a different quality. It's called something to continually being changed into a new kind of life that didn't exist. And it's the contrast of our new life in Christ compared to the old corrupt nature of what we used to do. So it's a quality, not a quantity of life. All right. And this light and momentary affliction. Okay. How can he say light and momentary? I feel like I'm going to die under the weight of this. I'll show you why. For this light and momentary affliction, preparing for us the eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. That's why he's saying out of this, that transforming you, you are looking towards the eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. Now, if you just struggle and you're miserable and bad things happen and your body falls apart, there's no eternal weight of glory waiting. But as we know him, as we allow him to transform us, that is the eternal weight of glory. And when you compare that to anything in this life, it's light and momentary. At best, it can't last 130 years. I don't think anybody, you know, in 2,000 to 3,000 years has lived to be 130, let's say 150. At best, it can last 150 years, and most people aren't living that long. So it is of this moment. Not going, oh, this is frivolous. He's already said, this really hurts. And he's going, but by comparison of knowing Jesus Christ and being transformed into his likeness, oh, by comparison, it's nothing. Okay? If you've ever given birth, okay, why would anyone ever go through labor? Because this light and momentary affliction is giving me a baby that's an eternal being. Okay? So it's a great picture. Same thing here is by comparison, and when you're in the middle of labor, by the way, if you're ever helping someone, don't go, don't worry, this is light momentary. You might get a black eye. You might be out for the count. Okay. But by comparison, it is a light momentary affliction because you're getting a human being. Okay. All right. It's the same picture here. He's not being frivolous and saying it doesn't hurt. He's saying, get the big picture. By comparison, it's nothing. Just like birth pains to getting a human being out of your body. Okay? That's the comparison.
Doesn't he refer to us somewhere too about like being just a drop? I mean, our life is
the... Oh, over and over it says, yeah. We're just a vapor.
Yeah.
Okay? If it lasts 70 years, 80 years, not, whatever. It's just a vapor. Yeah. Okay? Okay, this preparing or producing, it is the word, it's an intensify, that means way on steroids word. It means to work to the exact decisive conclusion. Okay? So it brings something about. Okay, it's producing. And it's a specific goal, not a general goal. It's like having a baby. There's one specific, exact conclusion we want out of labor, right? Mm-hmm. Not general like meals or getting a good grade on the ACT. I want a baby out of this. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's the same picture. And it in the word in Greek involves considerable expenditure of effort. That's the word that's producing for us an eternal weight of glory that outweighs them all. And it's actually preparing here, but it's the word to produce. Okay, so very much a picture of labor and delivery. And it's saying in the Greek, this is going to take extreme expenditure of effort. This is hard work, but it will produce a very specific goal. So that's that being renewed. Okay, so this hard stuff is producing, preparing for us for an eternal weight of glory beyond anything we could possibly compare. Then the key word. What's the first word in the New American, what am I going to say?
Easy.
Thank you. What's the first word of verse 18?
As.
What does as mean?
So, at the same time.
What? At this. That's going the same time. Mm-hmm. Okay. As I'm talking, this is being recorded. The two things are happening at the same time. So we have to do the as. Remember it said there's some really hard labor work that you have to do? I'm getting ready to show you what he wants you to do so you can live in this glorious comparative eternal weight. As, here's our work. We do not look, and this means like actually focus on, look at, the things that are seen. And this means physically we can see in this life. But to things that are unseen, which means you can't see. For the things that are seen are transient. It means it's just a season. And they're built to be made that way. But the things that are unseen are eternal. And this is like John 3:16. When he says we have eternal life, it doesn't mean lasts forever. It's not the idea of long. It's the quality of heaven. So this is saying that we want to look at things, not say, oh, someday I'll be in heaven. No. Eternal here is the quality of heaven. Quality of God. So, as we look not to the things that our eyes can see, but to the things our eyes can't see. For the things that we can see are meant to last a season. And can even be good stuff. Okay? My little tiny baby, the youngest of all five, has 3 months and 1 week before he graduates from college. Okay? That's a really good thing. Okay? All I've had. So, I look at the things that are eternal. Because although that was good, I don't want to fix my life on it. Mm-hmm. I've talked with two women this week who are really struggling because their babies are growing and moving on. Okay? It's a good thing, but it's meant for a season. Everything on this earth is transitory. Only human souls and the Word of God will go on into eternity, period. Okay? Unsaved go on into eternity. We go into eternal life. They don't have eternal life. We have eternal life. It's the quality of heaven. And it says, you have eternal life. We can have it. We can be experiencing. That's why it's worth such a comparative difference that it means nothing. Because we can be living the quality of heaven now. But what's the word that tells us in verse 18 that we have to work on? Ask. Okay? That's the thing. For 2 Corinthians 3:18, as we look at him, this image, we're being transformed. It's an as. So you want the good stuff? You have to work on it. And he's given us the tools, and he will be faithful. But we have it. This, again, we could go bigger than just Caribbean. The number of times I have turned to this verse in my life, because the things that are seen were crushing me. Okay? I have turned this verse over and over, saying, I choose to look not what is seen, but what is unseen. Because even though it's very real, it's transient, and the things that I cannot see of you are eternal. And I have lived and sucked the marrow of the bone of this verse. So I hand it to you, and again, memorize it. This is why I love 2 Corinthians 4. Look how many verses we have to memorize. This is life-giving, because it doesn't deny how hard it is. Look what we have in Jesus Christ. But look what we need to do to get there. Because we have, remember, we have to do the labor. That's our part. But we do it in the power of the Spirit. But I'm responsible. Okay. Question or comment or something.
But that's section that just says, for, let's see, for us an eternal weight of glory. Could you put that in different words? What is that?
The glory of heaven.
So we could...
The glory of heaven.
And he's just calling
okay,
it
of Jesus Christ. So, if we let God use all these afflictions to transform us, because we behold him and we're being transformed, because when's the last time you became a better person of higher character and more depth when something was easy? You can't name anything. Now, it doesn't mean they're not good and they're not wonderful, but I'm just telling you the good, the easy, the fun are delights, but they're not going to transform you. So he's very real about the pain and suffering. And he's saying, oh, by the way, your body's wasting away, but be renewed inside. Because whatever it is that's hard, whatever it is, it's just for a season. And I am working my life into you, Sarah. That's the eternal way. Wow. There is a great sermon written by Jonathan Edwards called The Weight of Glory.
Wow. I just have never heard
of The Weight of Glory by Jonathan Edwards. It's something else. Okay, but this is it. Like having a baby. But we get the life of Jesus Christ and the heavenly life now, which gives purpose to the suffering. But it has to be done God's way. Okay? Does that make sense?
It does, yes.
Anything else?
Well, I was just going to say, when you look that up on the Bible, so see, there's the word weight. Mm-hmm. And it does say, it says properly a weight. And then it says real substance carries personal and eternal significance.
Mm,
so
that helps
so it, like the word glory has the idea of weight to it as well. Mm-hmm. When you glorify it, there's a concept of weight in there.
Personal, so weight eternal is, significance.
So there.
Well, and then the affliction is described as light.
Yeah.
So if you go back to that pressed, crushed feeling, if you're in a trial and you just feel the weight of the trial, you know that compared to the glory, this is light.
This is why I have sucked the marrow out of these verses. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You're exactly right. So, unless your life is really easy, don't memorize this if you have an easy life. Don't memorize this if everybody you know never goes through really hard things. Okay? These verses are so life-giving. Okay? I promise you, you will do the same thing. And we look at it and go, there's no marrow on that bone. Because these verses have transformed my life. They have enabled me to survive when I go, okay, I'm Indiana Jones. Okay? I'm down on the map, and I'm not out of the camp. He has been faithful, and he's been faithful, and he's been faithful, and he's been faithful, 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 I'm telling you, I want to encourage you. This grace goes to more and more people in Thanksgiving. Okay, rejoice, because I'm telling you, if you haven't proven him, it's real. And these verses are the ones that